One of the most prevailing ideas about human intelligence is the view that people with larger heads and bigger brains are, on average, more intelligent than those with smaller heads and brains. This brilliant idea actually stems all the way back to the 1880s, when scientists Paul Broca and Francis Galton measured the head circumference of male students at the University of Cambridge and made correlations between head and brain size and intellectual ability. Despite the simplistic nature of the experiments and the many obvious design errors, the flawed conclusions of the study have somehow managed to persist for a very long time. In fact, they still persist to this day, and you can still find studies that hope to prove that big brain people really are smarter, whatever that means. These studies naturally permeate through to the media, and as a result, you'll frequently find articles published online pushing the narrative that big heads and brains somehow equals genius. Needless to say, having a big brain doesn't mean you're more likely to be smarter than someone with a smaller brain. In fact, these ideas are wrong, outdated, and frankly, really problematic. Allow me to explain. Initially, it kind of made sense that having a larger head with a larger brain would make someone more intelligent. After all, more brain real estate should mean more brain computational processing power available to you, which you could then use to handle more challenging cognitive tasks. It's a little like how Apple advertises its new M2 chip as being larger and therefore more powerful than its older yet smaller sibling, the M1 chip. The larger chip has room for more transistors, exactly 4 billion more transistors, which should, theoretically, allow the M2 chip to handle more demanding tasks and more abuse from end users such as ourselves. It makes perfect sense, right? Bigger must really be better. Well, not really. Because interestingly enough, these ideas about size also leaned heavily into the narrative that women and racial minorities were in some way intellectually inferior to their white male counterparts. That's because white men tend to have some of the largest heads and brains around. Men, for example, have brains that are around 10% larger than women, and as a result, have 16% more brain cells on average. Eerily similar to how Apple's M2 chip has 25% more transistors than the M1. In fact, Francis Galton, one of the two scientists I mentioned earlier, would go on to coin the term eugenics and became an avid proponent of social Darwinism. So, does this mean that men are 16% more intelligent than women? Well, obviously not. But don't take my word for it. Here's why. So while early IQ research did suggest that men were 2-3 IQ points smarter than women, the latest research tells us that there is in fact no statistical difference between the two sexes. And some of the latest studies even suggest the tables may have turned, and it's women who are now 2-3 IQ points more intelligent than men. This research seems to suggest that there are no genetic differences between the two sexes, and that any differences that ever existed in the past, present, or in the future are the direct result of access to education and participation in the workforce throughout adult life. In other words, if you don't use your brain power, you will gradually lose it over time, regardless of what sex or gender you may be. Altogether, the latest evidence seems to tell us that size doesn't actually matter all that much, and that bigger is not always better. In fact, other features of the brain play a much more crucial role in determining how intelligent we turn out to be. My name is Hashim, and I'm a medical doctor and University of Cambridge graduate. This is just one of the many videos I create here on YouTube about the human brain, where I explain how the brain works, why it sometimes doesn't, and what you can do to get the most out of it. To watch more videos just like this one, all you have to do is take action and subscribe, and you may just unlock your action potential. Like all my other videos, this video comes with citations, so check the description below if you're interested in learning more about this topic. A group of French scientists and doctors got a pretty epic surprise in 2007 when they examined the brain of a 44-year-old French civil servant. The civil servant was found to be missing around 90% of his brain. This was due to a condition known as non-communicating hydrocephalus. Yet he still had a verbal IQ score of 84, only slightly below the French average of 97. In fact, his chief complaint, or the reason why he decided to go and see his doctor, was a 2-week history of mild left leg weakness. Otherwise, he was just fine. While we should never treat exceptions and anecdotal evidence as definitive rules, we should remember that this case study does, in fact, agree with some of our other long-standing observations. For example, we know that while brain volume and the number of brain cells tend to steadily decrease in healthy individuals as they age, IQ scores remain more or less unchanged, until you're around 70 years old anyway, suggesting that head and brain size do not equal intellectual prowess, because, well, intellectual prowess is apparently what your dendrites are for. Dendrites are the finger-like projections found on the ends of brain cells. They're basically how electrical impulses or messages travel from one nerve cell to the next, and then the next, and so on, all the way across the brain. In other words, it's how different cells in the brain talk to each other. And as it turns out, the conversations that your brain cells have with each other play a critical role in determining how intelligent you turn out to be. According to a recent study, when nerve cells have more numerous, larger, and more complex dendrites, they can become a larger sink for electrical impulses from other nerve cells, meaning that they're essentially much more sensitive to any random signals that flicker in the brain. Having more dendrites means you can collect and process more information, increasing your brain's overall processing power without increasing the absolute number of brain cells. However, scientists now know that this is only true for a specific set of neurons known as the pyramidal neurons found in the brain's temporal lobe, the part of the brain that's involved in memory, language, and comprehension. That's because, for the rest of the brain, it's a slightly different story. Here's where it gets interesting. When scientists looked at neurons from the frontal and parietal lobes of the brain, they realized that unlike in the temporal lobe, higher IQ scores often correlated with fewer dendrites or connections, not more. That's because while pyramidal neurons in the temporal lobe must aggregate and process as much information as possible from different parts of the brain, neurons in the frontal and parietal lobes prioritize something completely different. The magic word is efficiency. During childhood, the brain is a little like a bonsai tree. It's constantly growing out new leaves and new branches, the dendrites and synapses of the brain. And similar to a bonsai tree, these dendrites and synapses later undergo extensive pruning, meaning that the brain loses the vast majority of all new connections it makes and only ends up keeping a select few, which happen to be the most efficient ones. While all roads may indeed lead to Rome, some roads are in fact shorter and consume fewer resources, which is good, because it means that your brain needs to work less hard to solve a particular problem, freeing up valuable brain processing power for more demanding tasks like the theory of general relativity, for example. This is in fact supported by brain imaging studies that show that the brains of children with higher IQ are less metabolically active and consume less energy than their peers when solving the same puzzle or problem. As counterintuitive as it may seem, smarter people are not more intelligent because they have the largest heads or the largest brains, nor is it because they're able to use more of their brains or make their brains work harder. Smarter people are smarter because their brains work smart, not hard. In other words, bigger is not always better, and metabolic efficiency matters much more than size or the number of neurons ever will. This brings me full circle back to Apple's chips. You may be interested to learn that Apple's latest M2 MacBooks are in fact not performing better or even nearly as well as the previous generation, the M1. That's because despite the M2 chips being larger and having 4 billion extra neurons, transistors, the M2 MacBooks run too hot and experience thermal throttling, meaning that they never truly reach their full processing power. In other words, because they are more active, they consume more energy and are therefore less efficient, proving the age-old theory once again that bigger is not always better, and metabolic efficiency matters a lot more than size.